Previously, we talked a lot about finding a good learning rate and adjusting learning rates using a learning rate scheduler. Now let's talk about the optimization algorithm itself. Here we are going to talk about a modification to the stochastic gradient descent optimizer using a momentum term. So the key idea here is to add a momentum term to dampen the oscillations. So in this slide, you see a surface plot of a loss function, and on the right-hand side, that's the point we want to reach, the solution, let's say the loss minimum. On the left-hand side is our starting point, and you can see when we use stochastic gradient descent without momentum that there are a lot of oscillations which over time shrink, and then at some point the algorithm will stop. Now here, if we add a momentum term now, we can see that we kind of dampen these oscillations, so there are fewer of these high frequency oscillations and the path is more like stretched out. And in this case also the algorithm reaches the optimal point here. So just for reference, we have here the stochastic gradient descent procedure at the top without the momentum term and at the bottom with the momentum term. And yeah, you can see that the momentum term kind of dampens these oscillations, pushing the optimization procedure in the right direction. So the key mechanism behind momentum is that we move still in the opposite direction of the gradient. So remember from unit 3 when we talked about stochastic gradient descent, the weight updates are always in the opposite direction of the gradient. So we still keep that part. However, now with this momentum term, in addition to that, we also move to the averaged direction of the last update. So in each round or in each step of the gradient descent update, we also take the averaged direction into account and add it to our update procedure. How this works, we will see in the upcoming slides. So here's an outline of the SGD algorithm. So this is a lot of information and we are going to walk through this step by step. So first, let's define the key variables here. So we have alpha for the learning rate, W0 for the parameters of the network. This includes the bias unit. Then we have L for the loss and mu for the momentum term. Now in this box here, these are the momentum steps. These are the new steps. If you ignore this box, it's essentially just like the regular SGD procedure. So everything that the momentum adds to the algorithm is shown here in this box, and we walk through this now step by step. So notice that there's also a variable T, and T stands for the time step. So if the time step is greater than 1, so after the first iteration, basically, we carry out this one step at the top. Otherwise, if we are in the first iteration, so if t equals 1, we carry out the operations shown in the lower box here. So as you can see here, there's just an assignment happening in the first round when t equals 1. So in this case, if t equals 1 in the first round, this algorithm here is exactly like the regular SGD algorithm. Now for the other rounds, if t is greater than 1, we do have this momentum term here that we add. And the computation of the momentum involves two terms. So we have mu, it's our momentum coefficient, it's essentially a scalar. And we have b here, and b is something we are carrying through the iterations. So b is something we keep reusing in each iteration. And notice here for the b, we have subscript t minus I, which refers to the previous iteration. So the value of b from the previous iteration. Now I know this is very abstract, so actually let's walk through this with a concrete example. Let's assume our momentum coefficient is mu equals 0.9, and assume we are in the first round. In the regular SGD procedure and also in the momentum SGD procedure, what we do first is compute the gradient here. And then since t equals 1, there's nothing really interesting happening in the center part, and we essentially just skip to the bottom here where we update the gradient. So the gradient is updated using this b term, which in this case is the same as the gradient in the first round. And then again, like in the regular SGD procedure, we update the weights by moving into the opposite direction of the gradient. So in other words, we update the weights by the negative gradient times the learning rate. Now let's assume we are in round 2. So let's assume we completed this first round. So t equals 2 now. In the second round, just like before, we first compute the gradient. And now since t equals 2, we enter this if statement here. So here we now use the momentum coefficient 0.9 and multiply it with the previous b value, which is essentially the original gradient from the first round. And then after we computed this term, we use it to update the weights. So instead of using the negative gradient, we are using this slightly modified negative gradient, which has now also this momentum coefficient included. So we covered a lot of conceptual theory here. How do we actually now use momentum in PyTorch? Luckily, using momentum in PyTorch is super simple. We can still use our SGD class in PyTorch and just have to make a small modification. So here we can set the value momentum equals to 0.9 to actually use a momentum term of 0.9. So in fact, the value for the momentum term is yet another hyperparameter. However, 0.9 is a common choice in practice. Now that we covered this momentum term, in the next video, let's introduce yet another optimization algorithm that is commonly used in practice. It will involve both a momentum term and an adaptive learning rate.